Right. Kind of wrapped up the DFT, and then the rest of the class, we're just gonna do review. So let me refresh your memory. What is it that we're doing?
We have a signal in the time domain. Some signal x to b. And what we do to get the frequency Fourier transform of this signal using discrete calculations are two things. First, we're just going to look at a truncated version of this signal, just to look at a portion of it, let's say from zero to some value t zero. So that's the first element that we need to understand for getting Fourier transform. The second element is where we cannot operate on a continuous signal. What we do instead, we sample the signal. So you get a whole bunch of, this was original signal. You get a whole bunch of samples of the signal. Okay. So this is a sample signal X, sample T. And then, what we do then is we apply the discrete Fourier transform on this set of samples. There's n zero samples here, where obviously n zero is equal to t zero over ts, where ts is the time between two adjacent samples. As a result of the discrete Fourier transform, you end up with a spectrum of the signal. We're going to actually not get the actual spectrum of the signal, but the sampled version of the spectrum. We're going to get samples of the spectrum of the signal. And also, this is not T, this is F. And also, we're going to get the sampled version of the signal, but not of the original signal. We're going to sample version of the spectrum of the truncated signal here, because that's the one that participates in a discrete Fourier transform. And that spectrum would look like somewhat like this, for example. Now, if the signal is real, as we know, the spectrum has to be even. But also, since this signal is sampled signal, then it is periodic extension. So you get the periodic nature of this signal. Now, you can pick any two period of this signal. It is customary to look at the signal between zero and fs, right? These and zero samples. So there will be n zero samples here. If you do this, let's say in MATLAB, it will give you, and you plot the magnitude of your DFT spectrum, you're going to get this kind of picture. And there is a function in MATLAB. Sometimes you want to see the spectrum about the origin. So there's something called FFT shift that will take this and then put it on this side here. And then you get really the baseband version of the spectrum, right? Around the origin, and that one has to be symmetric, has to be even. But it's customary to just see them this way, as this goes n samples in time domain, and there are n samples in a frequency domain. The samples here are referred to as XR in your movement in a frequency domain, and this sample here, n times X of NTS, is referred to as xn. Right, so this is the sample in the time domain, and this is the sample in the frequency domain. And we have a relationship that tells us how these xrs are calculated. This is our discrete Fourier transform, which is, and they're calculated as ts times sum when n goes from 0 to n 0 minus 1. X of NPS e to the minus J N times R times 2 pi F0 times ds. Now, we can simplify this somewhat. And I'm going to now realize that ts times x of nts is xn. So this becomes sum when n goes from 0 to n0 minus 1. So summation over these n minus 1, over these n0 symbols. This ts times x of nts I'm going to call xn. And let's simplify this guy here. It becomes n times r, but let me just put 2 pi, n times r, and then f0 times ts. What is f0 times ts? F0 times ts, well, is equal to ts over t0. Well, if you look at here, n0 is t0 over ts. So ts over t0 is 1 over n0. So it's 1 over n0. And then this ends up being this. And now somebody, we stop at this moment and we look at, well, this last expression that is the how we actually calculate or compute dft. And what you see here is an interesting thing. None of these parameters that I talked about, time, t0, ts, are part of this. You see that there's nowhere here that t0 and ts are participating. So the way how this ends up playing is you have n0 numbers that I'm going to call x0, x1, all the way to xn0. These are lowercase. And then through a DFT, this is going to be mapped into another, let me just for a second put here xn so that we know these are lowercase. It's going to map itself into x1, x2, xr, xn0. Right? Minus 1, let me just do it. Oh, 0, 1. So DFT transforms n numbers into n numbers. By itself, DFT is not, I would say, I don't know if it's a good word, it's not very smart. It doesn't know really what it's doing, right? All it does is this summation. There is no concept in what I'm showing here that a priori relates this to time, frequency, or any of that. It is when you understand what your sampling rate, what your sampling duration, that we can actually interpret these numbers in a proper way, right? All that FFT is going to do is you're going to feed it n0 numbers, and it's going to give you n0 numbers back. The first n0 numbers are going to be real. The ones that come back are going to be complex. But it is up to you to interpret what they actually mean.
Quick question. What's the difference between the n x of nts and ts times n?
Just the scaling. I mean, there's this, I would say, annoyance when you try to be mathematically correct. We actually demonstrated last time that this holds, right? That this is actually the estimate of the spectrum. And then there's this scaling factor that pops up here. So to make things a little bit easier for us, then we define the product of these two to be xn. And then we have, you know, the...
And also on your sampled signal there, you define xn as n times xn of ts.
Oh, no, not n, sorry, ts. That's fine, thank you. Sorry. Not n, cannot be n. Sorry. Good catch. Now, usually, you know, scaling is not much of a concern to us. What happens is, you know, you scale it anyway. You normalize it back and forth a lot of times. And the way how you would see most, in your book is somewhat unique because it actually cares about that stuff, right? It explicitly work with these scaling factors. Most books would actually just do this. XR is equal sum n goes from 0 to n 0 minus 1, xn e to the minus j 2 pi nr over n 0. And then they would say xn is equal 1 over n 0 sum n goes from 0 and 0 minus 1, xr e to the j 2 pi nr 0. So this is what is called discrete Fourier transform pair. Some books would split this and put 1 over square root of n0 here, 1 over square root of n0. There's not much importance to the scaling factors. I mean, there is obviously some importance, but in when you implement this, usually you take the Fourier transform, and what matters is not the overall power, but the relationship between the components. So you usually normalize everything to the highest component anyway, to make it equal to 1. All right, so let me give you a couple examples that talk about, connect some of these things together. Before that, let's talk about choice of Ts, T0, and zero. Those are very important choices from the implementation standpoint of the DFT. You know, to interpret and to do everything correctly, we have to have these numbers chosen. And what I'm going to do is first give you some steps how you do these choices, and then I'll work out an example that shows you what happens when you change these parameters and how you can what is it to be expected here. So there are essentially here I have four steps. So step one in choice of Ts, T0, and N0 is decide on the signal band. That's a little strange statement, right? Because what we we went into sampling theorem, we said, well, we're dealing only with band limited signals. Why do I need to decide what the bandwidth is going to be here? Well, one thing is the signal is band limited, but what we have to be aware is that as a result of this truncation in the time domain, there is spectral regrowth in the frequency domain. In other words, if I took the signal x of t and I just use t0 or portion of it, the spectrum of these two is not going to be the same. X of t might be a band-limited signal, but because this signal is finite, it's not band-limited anymore. To see that this is the case, so let me put it here as a note. One needs to be aware that x t zero of t, which is truncated. Version of x of t has infinite spectrum. How do I see that? Well, let's see this. Xt of t, which is the truncated version, can be written as u of t minus u of t minus t0 multiplying the original signal x of t. Right, that's the truncated version of the signal. So if I take the Fourier transform of this, xt0 of f, this becomes the Fourier transform of this guy, which is essentially pulse of t minus t0 over 2 divided by t0, and times the x of f. So you have a convolution because it's multiplication in the time domain. It is convolution in the frequency domain. So you have a convolution of the spectrum of X of F and sync signal. Since the sync, the spectrum of the sync signal, what, how large is, how wide is the spectrum of the sync signal? It's infinite. Then the spectrum of this guy is infinite. Now, we say, you know, and I'm probably failing to say that, because I asked this question so many times, but sync has an infinite spectrum. But is it really infinite, right? No, you know, after, because it dies, right? So if you look at it mathematically, it's infinite, because in mathematics, we are happy to deal with 10 to the minus 34, and we are okay with that, right? But in engineering, you know, if something is, let's say, 100 times smaller, then you're adding mouse and an elephant, and really you just have an elephant, right? And mouse is, you know, there if you want to nitpick. So what happens here is this sync here will die after certain number of loads, right, in the frequency domain. Now, when you do what controls how fast the sync dies? Well, if the pulse is really short, the sync is kind of broad in the frequency domain. It takes longer before it dies in the frequency domain. The longer the pulse in the time domain, the narrower the sync is in the frequency domain. So what happens here, you have the sync convolved with the spectrum of the signal, which blurs the spectrum of the signal in the frequency domain. But the narrower the sync is, the blurring is smaller. Well, what controls how narrow the sync is? The T0. The longer the T0 is, the narrower the sync is going to be in the frequency domain. And then this signal XT of F becomes relatively close to X of F. Right? So that will all gonna play a little bit later. But the first decision we need to do is make a decision on the bandwidth. And the way how you approach this practically, you say, OK, the bandwidth of X of T, which enters this system as a band-limited signal, is some number. Where I'm going to assume it's slightly larger because I want to push these guys away to take into account the fact that I'm going to be processing with just a window of the signal in the time domain. And how much is that budgeted depends on the application, maybe 20-30% of the bandwidth you take now as a signal bandwidth, and then you double that to get your sampling frequency. So once you decide what bandwidth is, step two is you have a straightforward choice. So you say FS. Let me just put some verbiage here. Once bandwidth is known, FS is set to be larger than twice the bandwidth, or your TS is smaller than 1/2b. Let me actually, just for the sake of, just make it the way it is. Don't even put equal, because it's never equal. It's always set to be larger than that. So now I have two, I have a choice of TS. The next thing is I need to select T0. And this is a T0 selection. T0 selection is guided by the requirement for the resolution in the frequency domain. What happens if you look at this plot here, the separation, and if you remember our sampling in the frequency domain, the separation between these frequencies here is 1/T0. So this delta F here is 1/T0. And this tells us how many samples, how close are these samples in the frequency domain. Choice of this T0 is dictating the resolution of the sampling in the frequency domain, but also, since we already have selected TS, will give us the number of points that we're gonna have in our discrete Fourier transform. So based on the resolution requirement, frequency domain, let's say delta F, we're going to choose T0 to be 1 over delta F. I have it here, F0, so let me just, so it's 1 over. And then the last step is step 4. Since we have already T0 and we have TS, the number of points N0 is going to be T0 over TS. So that gives us all the components. Now, for the computational reasons, this N0 is commonly chosen as power of 2. Right? And how do you do that? Well, what you do is you calculate N0 and then you round it up to the closest 2 to the N number. So let me work out an example here that exercises these 4 steps. So this is the same as the example 8, 7 in the text. It says x of t has a duration, I guess, and duration t0 equal to 2 milliseconds. So we have 2 milliseconds of a signal available. The bandwidth of the signal is 10 kilohertz. And required resolution in the frequency domain, so it's F0, is equal to 100 hertz. It says determine N0. So here is we are trying to utilize our discrete Fourier transform. We know that we're going to have 2 millisecond window to process the signal. And this usually comes that way, because in a lot of processing applications, we are actually given just a piece of a signal, and then we need to do something with that signal. So in entire processing budget that you have for the given application, there's going to be a window there that tells you, you have this much time to collect the data, and then this much time to process the data. So here, in this application, we are given 2 milliseconds of the signal, we know the characteristics of the signal, and we this is what we desire to in terms of resolution in a frequency domain. So if I now follow my approach over there, since I know the bandwidth of the signal, the sampling rate is going to be 2 times bandwidth, and it's going to be 2 times 10 kilohertz, which is going to be 20 kilohertz. So I'm going to sample at 20 kilohertz per second, which gives me TS, which is your sampling time, 1 over FS, 1 over 20 kilohertz. So this gives me a sampling time of 50 microseconds. So every 50 microseconds, I'm going to sample this particular signal. The second thing that I need to decide is F0. F0 is it's 100 hertz. So this gives me right away that T0 is going to be 1 over F0. So that tells me 1 over 100 hertz. And this is 10 milliseconds. Now there's a question for you. If I have a signal that for which I have 2 milliseconds, the acquisition of time, but if I want to have a resolution of 100 hertz in a frequency domain, then this tells me that I need to process 10 milliseconds of the signal. How do I do that?
Delay.
let me make sure I have the question clearly stated. So this is time axis T0. Let's say this is a signal. And what the problem says, you're going to have only, T equal 2 milliseconds of the signal. But I want you to give me the resolution of 100 hertz in a domain. This 100 hertz tells me how long the signal needs to be in a time domain. But since I have it only available for this portion, what I'm going to feed into processing is this. I'm going to feed the sampled version of the signal here. However, I'm trying to draw. I shoot myself in the foot because I need to draw this much more simple, right? So that I can make the samples there. So this is your original. And then from here to here, you're going to actually assume that the signal fell to zero. And then that up to T0, all the samples are equal to zero. This is called zero padding. Now, what does zero padding do in a frequency domain? You still have the same signal, right? This is the truncated version of this signal, right? You're sampling with the same period, same sampling rate. So what you're essentially having is this. You're having, let's say this is your FS. That hasn't changed between just processing this much of a signal and processing this much of a signal. So this is FS. Let's say this is a spectrum of a truncated version of the signal. Now, if you're processing just this piece, then what you're having is you're sampling the signal at delta F1. Let's say if I use these black samples, this is delta F1, which is 1 over T, right? So you're kind of, the author of the book uses a very good analogy. You're looking through a picket fence, right, to the same signal. But processing just this piece alone, or processing this with zero padding, you cannot change the spectrum of the signal. You're just changing how many openings in the fence you have. Now, in this case, when I put the zero padding, then my delta F2, I'm going to have more samples here, and delta F2 is going to be 1 over T0. I'm viewing the same spectrum, but I'm viewing it at a different resolution, right? So here, to meet the resolution requirements, I'm going to actually set this T0 to be 10 milliseconds. Once you know the T0 and TNs, then you end up having, you can easily determine N0. And in this case, T0 over TS is going to be 10 milliseconds divided by 50 microseconds. And this is 200. And now I say, well, I want this to be the power of the 2, so what is the next one is going to be 256 centimeters that I want to process. So I have now 250 samples, which is more than what I have required. So I'm introducing my processing, which is slightly more powerful than what is required to meet these requirements. So I can trade this extra processing power for two things. I can either increase the sampling rate, you know, to what I want to make sure, what I want to do is make N0 equal to 256. If you look at here, I can make N0 equal to slightly larger number by doing two things. If I keep TS constant and I increase T0, meaning I increase the number of zero pads here, what will be a consequence of that? I will get more openings in the picket fence to the same signal. So I'll be increasing the resolution in the frequency domain. If I can get 256 two different ways. That's one way. So keeping TS constant and increasing T0. Or I can keep T0 constant and decrease TS. If I do that, what is it that I'm going to accomplish? I'm going to actually, by increasing FS, I'm going to move these two away from each other and therefore reduce some of the aliasing here that happens as a result of a truncation. So you have to be aware of these two possibilities, and then, you know, depending on the set of circumstances, you can choose one or the other. But, you know, you go from 200 to 256, and you always increase the number of samples to the power of 2, and then you go back and look at what is it that I really want to improve. Do I want to improve the resolution in the frequency domain? If that's the case, then you work on your, then you increase T0 and decrease TS, or do I want to fight some of the aliasing that happens in the frequency domain? If that's the case, then I keep the T0 constant, and then I decrease TS or increase your sampling. All right, so let me do this to kind of examine what happens if I do one or the other. So, first approach is reducing aliasing error. And this is T0 kept constant. And then TS reduced. In this case, I'm going to set FS is equal to N0 times F0. F0 is kept constant, so I'm going to say this is F. So from here, there's a bug here. So this is going to be equal to 1 over N0 times T0, where T0 is 1 over F0. That's the time that I keep constant. So in our case here, this becomes 1 over T0 is 10 milliseconds. And now instead of having 200 samples, I'm going to put 256 samples, and I'm going to sample at 25.6 kilohertz. Right?
So this is trading some of this increased processing power that you hit, that you have as 256 from 200 to 256 to increase the to separate these lobes more and then decrease the aliasing in a frequency domain. Now the other alternative is to increase the resolution in frequency domain. And in that case, you keep TS constant, but T0 increase. So T0 is going to be N0 times TS, and it's going to be 256 times 15 microseconds, and this ends up being 12.8 milliseconds. So in this case, you end up with your F0, which is the resolution in a frequency domain, which is 1/T0, equal to 78.125 hertz. Right. So we went from this is we kept the same sampling rate, so with the separation in a frequency domain is the same, but we increased our resolution to 78 hertz instead of 100 hertz. And here we kept our resolution to 100 hertz, but we increased the sampling rate so to separate these now in the frequency domain more and reduce aliasing. Now, these are two extremes, right? You can actually have an intermediate solution where you do a little bit of both. You can say, okay, let me get a better resolution and improve my separation. And let's say mixed solution here. And let's say if I choose TS to be 45 microseconds instead of 50 microseconds that I had originally. And if I choose, then I have to choose T0 equal to 45 microseconds times 256, which gives you 11.5 milliseconds, and then N0 is 256. This gives me F0, which is 1/T0 equal to 86.96 hertz. So you have now this is a solution that's in between these two. You have a slightly higher sampling rate, you know, that corresponds to sampling time of 45 microseconds. You have slightly better resolution in the frequency domain, and then you have 256 samples. Now the question is, you know, I said it's customary to make these the number of samples the power of 2, and I haven't given any proof for that. The reason for that is computational efficiency, and let me just comment on that just by looking at the formula. XR is equal to sum when n goes from 0 to n0 minus 1, xn e to the minus j 2 pi nr over n0. So without going too much into theory and calculating this, here's what you should see. If you look at this xn as a sample, and this exponential here as also another value, then you have a multiplication here that you need to evaluate computationally. Right? So you're going to have here, to evaluate this sum, you're going to have n multiplications and n minus 1 addition. Right? Do you see that for each one of these? So you have, let's say, something that has n multiplications and n minus 1 addition. And then how many of these XRs you have? R goes from what?
r is going from 0 to n0 minus 1. So there's n0 of these coefficients, each one having essentially n multiplication, n0 multiplications and n0 minus 1 addition. So the problem of evaluating DFT has n0 squared complexity, right? It grows as n0 squared. Do you see that? You can think of it as essentially a matrix, right? You have XRs this way, you have XNs this way, and then the complexity of this grows as a square of the dimension of this matrix. If you make this number of samples equal to 156, due to the various symmetries and how you can actually do computations, you end up with something that's called fast Fourier transform that has a complexity n0 log base 2 of n0, right? So the number of computations here is going to be proportional to n0 times the log of n0. And that tells you how many operations need to do if you calculate it this particular way. Now, it doesn't seem like a big deal here, but let's look at an example, just a simple example. Let's say your n0 is equal to, let's say, 128. So what is n0 squared? Anybody with a calculator to help me? 128, so.
Sixteen three eighty-four.
And can you calculate n0 times log base 2 of n0?
N0.
128 times log base 2 of 128. Log base 2, you can do log of this divided by log 10. Right, this is how you get log base 2. Well, I don't even have to. What is the log base 2 of 128? 2 to the 7th, right? So it's 7 times 128. So it's 700, 840.
840.
And this 56.
No, no, no. All of
that. No, it's 7 times 128.
Oh, divided by, sorry.
No, no, 7 times 128.
896.
Yeah, 56, okay. 896. So look at the striking difference. If you're doing discrete Fourier transform, just like it's written here, you will have to do this many operations. If you do FFT approach, then you end up doing this many operations. So that's a really big module, right? If you divide these two numbers, what is it, 5% or 0.5%? Or is it 896 divided by 16,384?
It's actually 269. Would you do log 128 over log 10?
No, no. 0.0546.
It's supposed to be log 2.
It's supposed to be
log 2. Yes, log 2.
Yeah, but log
2 is...
log 2 of x, right, is equal log of x base 10 over log 10 of 2.
Right.
Yeah,
896 is right here, because this is 2 to the 7, 7 times 128. So what is 896 divided by 16?
0.0546.
0.05, so 5%.
Yes.
So this is now 5896 is roughly 5% of 16384. So it's 20 times faster, right, to do FFT than DFT. And so that's why we always round this to the nearest power of 2, not because we like to work with the power of 2, but because once you program this, you know, using the symmetry of the FFT,
then you end up with a tremendous computational savings. And the FFT is one of the most useful algorithms. As a matter of fact, I don't think
VFT has ever done is as written here. In math, I just got FFT to do performance here.
All right, so I'm going to give you a couple of problems to wrap this up. So 8, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4. And that's the last set of problems before the finals. All right, so that concludes the material. That's the end of the material for this course. I had a question at the beginning to go over zero order code and first order code. So let's address that question, and then if there's any time, let's go over some other problems. So,
excuse me, Professor.
Order board and first order. Go ahead.
How do we tackle using FFT whenever we want to reduce the noise? Yeah, if you know the spectrum, it's like the signal is over here. Can we use that to calculate?
Are you talking about aliasing? Do you only have a signal on there, or there's a signal plus one?
There's a signal processing, I think.
When you say this, right?
Yeah.
That's not the noise.
These no, I mean, graphic. This is the signal.
This is the signal itself, right?
Yeah.
So, it will have to wait, because that's a much broader topic, and we have windowing of the signal and how you actually use this kind of behavior. Right?
Oh, yeah,
windowing, right? Because remember, the way how I approach this, I said you have a signal, and then you just cut, you multiply that with the pulse. Well, that pulse, you should know by now, we don't really like pulses. I mean, they're nice analytically, but when you start implementing them, they result in sinks. And sink go forever, right? So what I would like to have is the signal that dies much faster than pulse, than sink, mm-hmm. that I multiply my signal. And then, there's various approaches, but essentially all of them lead to the same conclusion, that why this pulse is bad is because it has these sharp edges. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to round them up, make them round, right? And that's why you come into notion of windowing, then where you actually don't just take T0 of the signal, but take now the edges and kind of push them down. So round your pulse that you're using to pre-process the signal before you sample. And as a result of that, blurring of the spectrum becomes small. And there are different windows, Kaiser window, Wilbur window, all sorts of windows.
Yeah.
And with different properties. But to address your question, to reduce these things, you actually window.
Yeah, because that things like, I'm looking for difference between DFT and FFT, and I recall myself some of the problems.
Okay. So let's talk about zero order code. Do you have a specific question, or you want to go through the notes again, or you have a specific question?
I mean, like 8.23 is a good one.
8.23 is the there's a specific problem.
Okay. Let me see if I can do it. I don't know. It's a long one. 8.23. If you don't want to tackle that one, just maybe 8.22.
It's actually okay. I mean, it's a long text, but okay. Does it give an expression here in the book for first order code?
Yeah, it's the triangle.
I know. How do you? Okay. Let me, because I actually
doing this in the notes different. Here's a first, so first order home. It's not in the zero order home. First order home. Now, that's the problem with, I understand now what is the problem, because he gave you a solution before actually explaining what does first order hold do. The thing, the name of the game here is you have the samples, right? How do I get my signal back? The theory teaches us how you do that exactly. The sampling theorem says, okay, if you really want your signal back, then you have to do the reconstruction with a sync, right? This is what sampling theorem says. And it says x of t is equal to sum, look at this, n goes from minus infinity to plus infinity, x of nts, so there's your sample, and then here's your weighting function, sine pi fs t minus nts divided by pi fs t minus nts. And here's the picture that goes with it. Here's the time axis. Here are your samples. What I need to do is put the sync around every one of the samples and add them all together, and I will get my signal back. And the theorem says not only that you're going to get your signal back, there will be, it's not approximative, it's exactly what it is, right? That's your signal. Now, the principal difficulty of this is just this reconstruction process, that nobody can do it this way, right? Because you know, it's just not realistic that electronics that you design would actually wait for all of these tails or anticipate the tails that are coming from here. So this is nice theoretically, but very limited practical value. So now, the next thing that you say, okay, well, I know that I cannot do this, but how else can I do it? And then you say, well, the easiest way for me to do it is this, and this is what leads to zero order form. I'm going to say x of t, now it's going to be some sort of approximation, is going to be x of nts times the pulse that, actually, let me just write it exactly so they have the same. Oh, sorry. Is sum over n x of nts times the rectangle of t minus nts over ts. So what is the picture that goes with this? Well, here are your samples that are coming. And then you say something like this. The moment I get this sample, let's call it my special sample x. X is not this, right? Now, I'm going to say, well, what is the value of this function in this interval before the next sample comes? And zero order hold is lazy. It says, well, forget about it. I'm just going to say it's the same until I get different orders. I'm going to behave this way. So zero order hold is very lazy. It's kind of like no thinking here, right? And this is how you approximate your signal, right? Now, it's lazy, but it's actually very convenient. This is how our electronics works. You place the sample into digital to analog converter, and it will put that value on the line. And if you tell it to hold that value, it will hold it until you place another sample and say, convert this one to the analog voltage. So, and in this has a lot of applications. Usually, we follow this by some smoothing filter to get rid of, you know, these riffraff edges. But we understood what happened in the frequency domain. The reconstruction filter in the frequency domain here was a box, right? Remember that the ideal filter that cuts only the baseband. Here, the reconstruction filter is a box in the time domain, therefore it's a sink in the frequency domain. So we're using a low pass filter that's a sink, you know, and then because sink kind of doesn't die that fast, you're capturing all these high frequency components that helps you bring these edges. So maybe I should really draw the So this is my signal periodically extended through sampling. So the reconstruction view in frequency domain is this, you know, here this is x or that. The reconstruction view in a frequency domain of a zero order cone, you know, this is the, my signal again. Now your filter is this. Right? So it lets this guy go through, but it, you know, lets these other guys go through. So we usually follow the zero order cone by another low pass filter that will do this. Right? In analog domain. Now, what about first order cone? Let me actually start from here, and then we'll derive what this thing is in both domains. I have my sample.
Professor, isn't the first order hold a triangle?
Well, that's where you say, but where is the triangle coming from? That's where the confusion is. You know, that's where you say, he gave you the solution, but why is it triangle? So let's understand the thinking. What yields that triangle? So now you're smarter. You say, okay, well, you know, this was kind of pretty rough. So what's the next logical approach? The next logical approach is, how about this? Right? That seems to be better. Let's connect this. So now you say, well, what kind of filter gives me this kind of approximation?
Sig squared.
How do you know it's sig squared? To determine that.
But it was on the last test.
To determine that, here's how I'm gonna actually put an impulse into the system. And impulse looks like this, right? So what is the impulse response of the filter that connects the dots? Right? These are the dots, right? So this is my this is my input right now that I'm drawing input. Now my response is going to be connected dots. So the impulse response of that filter is this. And here's your triangle, right? So why triangle? Because triangle connects the dots, right? So that's the, you know, that's the reason why it's triangle. Now once I know that it's triangle, impulse response is a triangle, I know what the reconstruction does. This is a sig squared because the Fourier transform of the triangle is sig squared. So sig squared kind of falls faster than the regular sig. I'm kind of overstating it there so that you get. So it has a better filtering properties, right? It's not as rough. We usually follow this also with some sort of low pass filter, but it's more mild than the one here, right? Because the edges are not rough as here. Now, what are the trade-offs in this one here to reconstruct in between here? Theoretically speaking, you have all the samples participate because they're all adding their tails up to create this response in between adjacent samples, right? Even the sample that's where over here, you know, tail kind of propagates all the way here. So here, you have all the samples participate. Delay to reconstruct signal this way needs to be infinite. I need to wait for all the samples to come in before I get the first sample, right? Because theoretically, even the last sample that I sample will have impact on the first. How about delay here? Delay here is instantaneous. That's why this is attractive. The moment I get the value, I reconstruct the signal in this area. Then when I get the next one, I'm moving along. So here, to generate the output, all you need is the current value of the sample, right? So the memory of this is infinite, memory of this is 1, memory of this is 2. You need 2 adjacent samples. So to understand what is happening between current sample and the next sample, you have to wait for the next sample. And then once the next sample comes, you have idea what's in between. And then when the next one comes, then you follow it. So the memory here is infinite, memory here is 1, memory here is 2, right? Now, let me ask you this. Now you can see that this can be generalized. I can now say, okay, well, instead of connecting these two, I can take this one, and this one, and draw a smooth curve through them. And this is called spline interpolation. And that's one of the best way to interpolate things in MATLAB. If you have samples, look it up. It's called spline interpolation, and it's doing exactly that. It's kind of taking three samples at a time, and the curves you get are very smooth and very nice. This would be a second order hold, right? And you can kind of go to the nth order hold where you process n samples at a time. And every time you're getting smoother and smoother response, closer and closer to this ideal one, but with a memory that goes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 samples at a time. Now, once you go and we kind of fix this part, well, let's fix this part. What does x of t look like in this case? X of t is equal to x of nts plus t minus nts over ts x of n plus 1 n plus 1 ts minus x of nts. That's it. For t between nts and n plus 1 ts. So this interval between two samples, nts and n plus 1 ts, this is the equation for x of t, the filtering equation for x of t. Now, what is this? This is you can see this is a straight line, right? This is, all of these are constants, right? These samples are constants. So this is some ax plus b kind of thing. T is the variable, and you can see that this is a straight line. So, and then when t is equal to nts, this whole thing goes away, and then the value is x of nts, so the value of the sample at the ts. When t is equal to n plus 1 ts, then this becomes n plus 1 ts minus nts, which is ts, cancels ts, then these two guys go away, and you're left with the next sample. So what this does, it connects the two dots. And that's the answer to the question in the problem that says, show that first order hold is actually doing linear interpolation, right? And that's how, this is actually the starting problem, you know. This is how you actually get to first order hold, by thinking, okay, I don't want to do this rough approximation here, I want to do the linear interpolation between the points. And then from there, I guess all the other questions can be answered. So it says, what is the minimum delay required to make this realizable? How much do I need to delay to make this realizable? Well, I need this to be on this side, right? So delay of a single sample makes this realizable, right? I don't need a delay here. This is immediately realizable. Here, I have to wait for the next sample before I produce. So the input-output at this time is going to depend on the input that was collected for the next sample. So that's why you have to delay, you have to wait for the next sample to come to start reconstructing after this sample. So delay here of a single sample makes this realizable, and so on. For nth order hold, the delay is going to be n samples before it becomes realized. Does this answer questions? Okay. All right. So. I need to stop because you need to do a test here. That's that evaluation stuff for the course.
Oh, your test?
Yeah. Test of you're evaluating the course. So I'm going to ask Andy again, because you're taking the care of most of the questions. And
I finished the RF one, so yeah. I will
give it to Carol. Just this is, I forgot to say, for the other course, this one asked you for the name of the instructor.
No,
And the course is ECE. What's the course number?
5201.
5201.
No. 5201. Maybe I okay, so you know that the next class is review, so we're just going to go over the problems and discuss the findings.
You